Welcome back. Now, if you'll remember from our last video, we finished discussing the geography of sub-Saharan Africa. Now, this presentation will introduce the physical and historical geographies of Australia and the Pacific region. Now, keep in mind that this is a massive region and contains hundreds of volcanic islands, coral atolls, and archipelagos, so it's really extremely difficult to cover all of these islands. Now, for this reason, we will only focus on the major island groupings, not individual island names. Australia is, of course, the major body of land and largest country in the region. To the southeast of Australia sits New Zealand, made up of its north and south islands. Starting from west and moving east, we have Palau, the Federated States of Micronesia, Guam, Northern Mariana Islands, Marshall Islands, Nauru, Papua New Guinea, Solomon Islands, Vanuatu, New Caledonia, Tuvalu, Kiribati, Samoa, Fiji, Tonga, American Samoa, the Cook Islands, French Polynesia, and then off the edge of the map here is Easter Island, also called Rapa Nui, and then up here in the north is Hawaii. Australia and Oceania is a giant and geologically active region that contains numerous landforms across space. Australia is home to the Great Victoria Desert, located here to the west, and the Great Dividing Range along the east coast, located here. Now, the Darling and Murray Rivers, here in the southern end, feed a large portion of Australia's population and act as a major transportation hub for goods and services in the eastern half of this country. Now, the island of Tasmania sits to the south and is separated from Australia by the Bass Strait, located here. The Tasman Sea sits in between Australia and New Zealand and acts as a major transportation highway between these two countries. Now, the Coral Sea sits to the northeast of Australia and contains the beautiful Great Barrier Reef, the world's most famous, Torres Strait, divides New Guinea and Australia, and of course the massive Pacific Ocean here spans the length of Oceania and contains about 30% of the world's water. Now, this vast expanse of territory is home to roughly 42.5 million people. If territory were measured by land and water, the ancient Polynesian culture would have been considered the largest society to have ever existed. So before we get started, let's watch this quick clip from National Geographic. It's titled Lindblad Expeditions of French Polynesia.
It sends shivers up my spine when I just think about walking around here.
It's just filled with life. What a cool place.
This island redefines what remote really means.
It's just very beautiful. It looks like a movie set.
It's absolutely gorgeous with trees, birds, and deserted beaches.
It's not any one thing. It's cultural, it's wildlife, and it's scenic beauty.
I just find I'm still pinching myself to believe this is where we are. It's just magical.
Huge region in the center of the Southeast Pacific with five main archipelagos with all sorts of different little varieties of climate, beautiful lagoons, huge mountains, deep valleys, and certainly a high diversity of cultures which are all variants of the same central Polynesian culture.
Great.
We had a little extra time up our sleeve, and we thought, let's do some exploring. And looking at the chart, we found this amazing atoll. A little extra time, we take a chance, we do some exploring, and sometimes we hit the jackpot, and we sure did today. This is the Robinson Crusoe Island. This is everybody's ideal of the South Seas tropical paradise, that if you got shipwrecked, you'd want to be shipwrecked here.
It is impossible to get here, and it's a super thing that Lindblad National Geographic have offered an opportunity to come to a place that even they had never been before.
It is the quintessential uninhabited island that you always dream about. And the sun is shining, and the boat looks great on the sea, and I mean, this is why you come to the South Pacific.
The undersea world in the South Pacific is an amazing place to discover. It's warm, it's clear. You've got above water scenes like this, and you've got beautiful coral, beautiful fish, great diversity of things. It's really just a wonderful, wonderful place.
This is the center of it all. People have been very gracious and welcoming. We just had a kava ceremony, and people are sitting over there singing and just having a great time here.
What's the trip been about? It's all been just so magnificent. We're just so beautiful. And I don't know whether you caught, but I really had tears in my eyes when I left.
It's an absolutely beautiful area. Can't deny that. Now, normally when we discuss physical landscapes and the environment in a region, we focus on landforms and view the ocean really as an afterthought. Now, while Australia is a massive piece of territory, the vast majority of Oceania is water. So this region will focus on our attention on both land and water resources. Now, because of the size of Australia and Oceania, it is often divided into four main subregions called Micronesia, Melanesia, Polynesia, and Australia. I'll make this slide a little bit bigger so you can see it. Now, as the Austronesian people migrated across this region between 1500 BC and 1200 AD, they named these islands based on cultural attributes and the natural features found on these islands. One important example is the islands of New Zealand. When the Maori people first landed on the North Island around 1200 AD, they named this island Aotearoa, which roughly translates into Land of the Long White Cloud. Now, this may have been in reference to the mountainous landscapes and surrounding clouds that can be seen from a distance on an outrigging canoe. Now, plate tectonics play a major role in landform and marine colony formation in this region as they create the islands that form the coral reefs. Now, the interaction between plates in the Pacific lead to the creation of composite volcanoes along subduction zones and shield volcanoes over hot spots near the center of tectonic plates. Now, when tectonic activity along plate boundaries form islands, these islands often form a series of island chains known as archipelagos. The best example of an archipelago in the Pacific is the Federated States of Micronesia, with 607 islands covering 271 square miles. And we can get a better idea of that over here. I'll expand this a little bit so that we can see it. And you can see here the Federated States of Micronesia, a series of islands located clumped and close together. These clustered islands make up the archipelago of the Federated States of Micronesia. Now, of course, Micronesia is much larger than that, and you can actually see the home island here of Micronesia and several atolls that form around that particular island. Now, later in this presentation, we will discuss the forces that create the volcanic islands and atolls. Then we'll discuss the processes that make Hawaii unique among the Polynesian islands. Now, before we get to the Pacific Islands, it's important to note that Australia is a massive territory and is not so different from the United States. The contiguous United States is about 3.7 million square miles, while Australia is roughly 2.97 million square miles, as you can see here. Now, the map shown on this slide shows Australia overlaying with the United States. The physical similarities don't just stop at size, largely because both territories are located at similar latitudes, so both have very similar climates. The major differences are due to location north and south of the equator and prevailing oceanic winds. Now, we will look closer at Australia's climate a little later. So to better understand how cultures and physical landscape interact, geographers have divided the Pacific Islands into three main subgroups known as Melanesia, Micronesia, and Polynesia. Essentially, Nesia translates into islands or lands and is placed at the end of each regional name. Micronesia lies to the north here, you can see it in purple, lies north of the equator and west of the international dateline. This region includes the Mariana Islands, Guam, Carolina Islands, Marshall Islands, and Kiribati. The name Micronesia just simply means small islands and is the most sparsely populated region of the Pacific Islands. Now, Melanesia is located to the south of Micronesia here in green, and is located in the western part of Oceania. Now, this subregion includes the islands of New Guinea, Bismarck Archipelago, Solomon Islands, Santa Cruz, Vanuatu, Fiji, and New Caledonia. The name translates into essentially black islands and is named for the darker skin inhabitants on these islands. Now, these islands are physically and culturally diverse and were probably settled by the people of New Guinea around 1300 BC. Now finally, Polynesia, here in the yellow, is the largest subregion and contains all of the remaining islands in the Pacific Ocean that are directly linked to this Austronesian group. This subregion contains the islands of Tuvalu, Tukalau, Samoa, Tonga, and the Kermadec Islands to the west, the Cook Islands, Society Islands, and the Austral Islands in the center, and the Marquesas Islands, Tuamotu, Mangareva Islands, and Easter Islands to the far east. Now, some geographers also include New Zealand, but others include New Zealand in the subregion of Australasia. But for right now, we'll keep New Zealand as part of Australasia, so don't pay much attention to that here in this Polynesian map. Now, location and physical geography play such a major role in Oceania, and without tectonic activity in the Pacific, these islands would not exist. Now, the Pacific Ring of Fire, also known as the Circum-Pacific Belt, is a 25,000-mile horseshoe-shaped basin that is associated with a nearly continuous series of oceanic trenches, volcanic arcs, volcanic belts, and plate movements. Now, the Pacific Ring of Fire occurs because of a series of tectonic plates that are converging to form these volcanic islands in subduction zones. While we've mentioned this region before, we haven't really discussed how important this region is to the development of Oceania. Now, without tectonic activity around the Pacific Ring of Fire, these islands would not exist. Most of the islands in the Pacific are created by the interaction of the Eurasian, Australian, Philippine, and Pacific plate. Now, the Pacific plate is currently expanding, and the convergence of this plate with the Australian and Philippine plate is ultimately responsible for the creation of Micronesia, Melanesia, and Polynesia. Now, as you can see from this map here on the right, the boundaries between Australian, Philippine, and Pacific plates located here, 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 and here are converging and have resulted in the creation of deep trenches throughout the Pacific Ocean. Because the Pacific plate is made of denser materials than the other two plates, it is submerging underneath the Australian and Philippine plates, creating these deep underwater trenches. As a result, the Philippine and Australian plates are forced to rise above the ocean surface, creating the islands of Micronesia and Melanesia. Now, because of these tectonic forces, the Pacific plate has also risen in some major locations across this region and created the Polynesian Islands that populate much of the South and Equatorial Pacific. Now, convergent boundaries are largely responsible for the creation of these islands in the Pacific. Now, if you can remember back to the presentation on South Asia's physical geography, you'll remember that we introduced convergent boundaries. A convergent boundary is a tectonic boundary where two plates are moving toward each other. Now, if the plates are equally dense, they usually push up against each other, forming a mountain chain. If they are of unequal density, one plate usually sinks beneath the other in a subduction zone. While plates converge, they do so in one of three settings. Oceanic plates collide with each other, forming oceanic-oceanic boundaries. Oceanic plates collide with continental plates, forming oceanic-continental boundaries. Or continental plates collide with each other, forming continental-continental boundaries. Now, the points at which the Philippine and Australian plates meet the Pacific plate are examples of oceanic convergent boundaries. As the two high-density plates made contact, the denser Pacific plate slid under the less dense Philippine and Australian plates. Now, because the Pacific plate sunk under the other two plates, the biggest island of islands are located over the Philippine and Australian plates. Now, however, I would like to mention this, the sheer force of this interaction created many of these islands that we see located in Polynesia. And you can get an idea of this relationship from the diagram here in the upper right with the confluence and convergence of oceanic crust into oceanic crust. And then here we have the convergence of continental crust here as well. Now, as you can see from this slide, the region around the Pacific, Australian and Philippine plate boundaries have extensive landform development. If you look at the satellite image on the left here, you can see that many of these islands east of Australia form linear chains that follow the western part of these boundaries, as seen here in this blue square. Now, the map on the right here shows hypothetical movements of major landforms over 250 million years. Now, the prevailing theory states that during the Triassic period around 200 million years ago, Gondwana land began to split and Australia and Antarctica moved eastward towards modern-day Pacific Ocean. Australia may have split from Antarctica around 145 million years ago as it began to converge with the Pacific Plate. As it began to overcome the Pacific Plate around 65 million years ago, the Pacific Plate submerged under the Philippine and Australian plates, creating the islands of the Pacific. Now, there is a caveat here, because we've discussed this before. This particular theory has ran into several problems over the years, and some scholars have argued that it fails to explain everything, and so you should take really this theory with some grain of salt and keep in mind that none of this has been proven with beyond a reasonable doubt, and that there are still lots of questions that have not been answered. Now, when oceanic plates converge, it results in the creation of oceanic trenches and volcanic islands. Volcanic islands can occur in oceanic basins such as the Hawaiian Islands or on or near ocean ridges such as the Fiji Islands. Volcanic islands are essentially large volcanoes that have erupted on the seafloor, and the tops of these volcanoes have emerged above sea level. Now, volcanic islands and seamounts, i.e. submerged volcanoes, range in tectonic stability from intermediate or unstable in areas where volcanism is active to stable in areas of extinct volcanism, such as Easter Island. Composite volcanic shields form along plate boundaries, while shield volcanoes form over hotspots near the center of oceanic plates. Now, gyets are flat-topped seamounts produced by erosion at sea level, followed by submersion, probably due to the sinking of the seafloor. Now, coral reefs grow on some of these gyotes as they sink, producing atolls. Now, some of the large volcanic islands may have developed over mantle plumes, which are the magma sources. Now, coral reefs begin to form when free-swimming coral larvae attach to submerged rocks or other hard surfaces along the edges of islands or continents. As the corals grow and expand, reefs take on one of three major characteristic structures: fringing, barrier, or atoll. Now, fringing reefs, which are most common, project seaward directly from the shore, forming borders along the shoreline and surrounding islands. Now, barrier reefs are also border shorelines, but at a much greater distance. They are separated from their adjacent landmass by a lagoon or of open, often deep water. Now, if a fringing reef forms around a volcanic island that subsides completely below sea level while the coral continues to grow upwards, an atoll forms. As you can see from this, We have the volcano. As the volcano becomes eroded, it collapses onto itself, and what we have left is the creation of this coral atoll surrounded by reefs, and within the inside of it, a lagoon. Now, atolls are usually circular or oval with this central lagoon. Parts of the reef platforms may emerge as one or more islands, and gaps in the reef provide access to this central lagoon. So we can actually see this, and it's good that we already have the Federated States of Micronesia open up over here on Google Maps, because you can get at least a better idea here. So if we zoom into this, you can actually see the formation of coral reefs in the process. So as this island became bigger, now this is a volcanic island, as this volcanic island became bigger and the seafloor around it raised with the island itself, coral larvae was attracted around the outer edges of this particular platform. Now eventually, if we fast forward, we'll get the formation of what is a coral atoll. Now this atoll here is known as the Ant Atoll, and part of it is above water, and as you can see, part of it is below water. So this slide shows examples of coral reefs, volcanic islands, the creation of coral reefs around volcanic islands, and the resulting atoll that forms over time. Now the picture on the upper left here shows an underwater photo of the Great Barrier Reef, which is considered to be one of the most beautiful places to dive around the world. Now the picture in the top right here is the White Island off the coast of New Zealand. Now this is a fairly new island and recently erupted in December of 2019. Notice that there are no visible coral reefs developing around this particular island, which leads us to the assumption that it is a fairly new island. Now, if we fast forward several hundred years, this island may look like the island pictured in the bottom left here. Now, this is a satellite photo of the island of Tupuai in French Polynesia. Now, if you look around the outside of this volcanic island, you'll see a coral reef developing and creating a lagoon here. Now, this lagoon is an excellent source of fishing for the island's inhabitants. And then finally, if we fast forward several centuries, this island may begin to look like the Tyro Atoll of French Polynesia, which is pictured here on the right. Over time, volcanoes collapse, forming a caldera. On land, this caldera is visible. However, when volcanic islands collapse, all that is visible above the oceanic surface is the resulting coral atoll. The water in the middle here is called the lagoon. While many volcanic islands are formed due to subduction zones under the oceanic surface, some islands are formed from the creation of shield volcanoes over hot spots in the center of oceanic plates. One example is Hawaii. This chain of more than 15 islands was formed as the lithospheric plate moved over a hot spot and an active shield volcano formed under the ocean's floor. Over time, more lithospheres formed as lava constantly flows from these volcanoes, and eventually the newly formed lithosphere will appear above the ocean's surface. Now, the Hawaiian archipelago is part of a highly active group of volcanoes that differ from other Polynesian islands because of the nature of these volcanoes. Instead of having violent eruptions, these islands have fairly constant eruptions of slow-moving lava that cool relatively quickly as it hits the air. And we can find Hawaii on a map here on the right fairly easily. Most of the time when we think of Hawaii, we think of just these main islands here, but actually these islands continue on for some distance. And in fact, many of these are still submerged under the ocean surface. And if we fast forward just a few hundred years, these will peer their heads above the ocean surface, creating more landform. Now, as mentioned before, coral reefs develop along coastlines as coral larvae settle along raised surfaces in the ocean floor. Now, one of the best examples of this is the Great Barrier Reef, located off the northeastern coast of Australia. Now, thousands of tourists visit this destination every year. Now, the picture on the left here is a photograph taken by a diving team. As you can see, reefs are home to thousands of species of marine life and act as a major source of food for fish and sharks. Now, the picture on the right is a satellite image of a portion of the Great Barrier Reef. Now, as the slide says, the Great Barrier Reef is the world's largest reef and is made up of 2,900 individual reefs, covering 344,400 square miles northeast of Australia. We can actually see that here on Google Earth as well. And without even zooming in that far, you can see the Great Barrier Reef located here, which brings in millions of dollars every year in tourism to this northeastern part of Australia. And you can see the confluence and conflagration of these coral reefs along the ocean floor. So let's watch this quick clip from National Geographic. It's about the Great Barrier Reef.
From space, the east coast of Australia appears to be in the embrace of a giant opal. The largest living structure on Earth, the Great Barrier Reef, is a lacy, living wall spanning more than 2,000 kilometers of islands and submerged reefs between the Queensland coast and the western edge of the Pacific Ocean. Diving in, the opal seems to splinter into millions of pieces, whirlpools of small metallic blue fish, barracuda gliding like silver submarines, and occasionally a lone predatory shark. Great Barrier Reef is like an underwater city whose buildings are alive with millions of small creatures whose lives are intimately and intricately connected. It is as diverse as a rainforest, a mosaic of more than 70 types of habitats hosting thousands of species of marine life. As many as 100 different kinds of coral may occupy a single acre of ocean. Molecule by molecule, coral animals gradually extract calcium carbonate from the surrounding water to form minute stony cups around each animal's soft crown of tentacles. Some corals live in solitary splendor, but most are built with hundreds, sometimes thousands, of individual animals linked together to form a single coral mound, plate, or cluster of branches. Some are like little trees and shrubs. They provide food and shelter for thousands of other forms of life. Corals get the credit for most of the reef structure, but much of the construction is done by fast-growing, encrusting red algae. They act like pink glue, cementing fragments of shell, sand, and coral with sheets of calcium carbonate. Is home to more than 4,000 kinds of mollusks, from tiny sea slugs, nudibranchs, to giant clams. Green sea turtles travel thousands of miles in the open sea to reach the sandy beaches of some of the Barrier Reef's islands, and there to lay their eggs. Hatchlings head straight for the sea. They will travel thousands of miles over the years and eventually return to lay their own eggs.
Okay, we'll stop it there. It's an absolutely beautiful location, and again, this video is gives you at least a little bit of an idea of how this area has developed, but it really doesn't do it justice. So I would suggest, if you have some time, do a little research on the Great Barrier Reef yourself, and I think you'll be impressed. Now, another example of the impact that tectonic movements have on the ocean floor is the Mariana Trench. Now, this is the deepest trench in the world and is located in the Western Pacific Ocean just south of Japan. Now, the deepest known point was recorded at a depth of 36,037 feet. Now, if you place Mount Everest in the Mariana Trench, it would be short of the ocean surface by about 7,000 feet. To get an idea of where this is located, when you look at Japan, this is essentially that Mariana Trench, this black location that follows the ridges to the west. Let's to give you an idea of a little bit more detail about the extents of the Mariana Trench, there was recently a study done, and robots were sent to the bottom of the trench and attempted to extract some data. So we've got a short clip here we'll look at, and it'll kind of give you an idea of what went behind this.
Surface LF depth 109 or 28 meters.
Okay.
Ben.
Okay, Roger that. We'll go for a release.
Life support good. Depth 109 or 28 meters. At bottom. Repeat. At bottom.
At the bottom?
Yep.
Roger, LF. Understand you are on the bottom. Congratulations, Victor. Congratulations.
Well done. Beginning exploration of the bottom.
Well done.
You did it, buddy. Well you done. Did it.
We all did it. We all did it. Captain Walsh. Well done, sir. Thank you. Thanks for showing the way.
You're my hero.
Thank you. No, you're mine. It was an amazing experience. It was an amazing dive. I think almost exactly 12 hours, about 3.5 down, 4 hours on the bottom. I think the longest anyone's ever been on the bottom of the Challenger Deep, and then about 4 hours up. I went through pretty much all of my electrical power and had to be swapping batteries around and circuits around. It was a great journey. Saw some really interesting things on the bottom.
Now, because of the sheer force of the weight of the water above it, that's why it's been so complicated and been so difficult to send explorers down to this particular area which they're talking about, which is this Challenger Deep. And so that was one of the first attempts to send a person down there. Prior to that, several robots had been sent down there, and in some cases they've been lost and or destroyed due to the sheer weight of the oceanic waters. The vast expanse of the Pacific Ocean has yet to have been explored, and we still have really no idea what type of life forms live, especially in the Mariana Trench. Now, because of the, again, vast expanse of Australia and the Pacific, now climates can differ greatly across space and are highly dependent on ocean currents, the ITCZ, and monsoons. Now, recent changes in sea level have also impacted the lives of people on these islands, as some of them are at risk of disappearing completely. Now, another major issue to consider in this region is biological diversity. Because of the size of Australia and its relative isolation for thousands of years, this area is home to species of animals that don't exist in any other region discussed so far. Now, we will discuss some examples later, but it's important to mention that the introduction of invasive species by European settlers in 1788 had a negative impact on the endemic species of flora and fauna. So the major climate regions, before I get started, make this a little bit bigger so you can see it better. Now, the major climate regions of Australia and the Pacific have a major impact on settlement patterns in places like Australia, but less of an impact on the islands of the Pacific. Now, if you look at this map, you'll see the tropical wet climates are contingent on proximity to the equator. This zone is represented in this rust-colored red that you see here on the island of New Guinea, and contains, of course, Papua New Guinea and most of the islands between 20 degrees latitude north and 20 degrees latitude south. Now, this is largely due to the movement of the ITCZ as it crosses these islands during the spring and fall, bringing them rain for most of the year. Islands located above 20 degrees north up here and 20 degrees south down here, and the northern tip of Australia located here around the city of Darwin, are in the tropical wet dry climate, which is marked by heavy monsoons during the summer months, again because of the movements of the ITCZ. Now, the largest percentage of Australia and New Zealand's population live within the mid-latitudes and Mediterranean climates. Mid-latitude climates have rain for most of the year with warm summers and cool winters and are represented by this green color here on the map. Mediterranean climates have a similar temperature to the mid-latitude climates but receive most of their rain in the winter, and those are represented by this light green located here around Perth and Adelaide. Now, mid-latitude climates in Australia are located, again, along the eastern coast of the mainland and Tasmania, while most of New Zealand is considered mid-latitude climate as well. However, the inland portion, as you can see here, or the Southern Alps, is considered a continental climate because of the larger temperature ranges between summer and winter. Because of the vast size of Australia, a large portion of its climate is considered desert or steppe, presented here in yellow and then tan. This is caused by three variables: continentality, rain shadow, and latitude. Australia is located under a high pressure trough that forces precipitation out from its center, creating a hot desert called the outback. Now, the desert and steppe of Australia is also precipitated by the Great Dividing Range along the east coast, as you can see here. As warm, moist air approaches this shoreline and then moves over the mountain, leaving only hot, dry air for the remaining part of the country. Now, finally, because of the size of Australia and distance from moist oceanic air, continentality keeps the innermost part of the country here much drier than the coast. Now, small subtropical climates exist over the city of Mackay, located here in this sort of lighter shade of green. Now, this is just south of the tropical wet dry climate of northern Australia. Now, this region is marked by hot summer temperatures, cool winter temperatures, and it receives most of its rain in the summer. Now, this slide shows a selected group of climagraphs in Australia and the Pacific. The graph on the upper left here is Napari Kiribati, which is considered a tropical wet climate. It receives rain throughout the year, but most of its rain occurs here between January and July, with a slight dip during the fall as the ITCZ moves back to the South Pacific. Because of Kiribati's location at 3.3 degrees south of the equator, its temperature remains the same all year round, at about 28 degrees. We can find Kiribati here on Google Earth. And you can see its location as it compares with the rest of the Pacific, and it's located just near the equator. Now, if we can get closer to it before it disappears. Interesting. These are all parts of the Kiribati island chain, but it's interesting how it just disappears. There it is. Okay, so there's the main island of Kiribati. That's actually a pretty big tourist destination. All right, the graph in the upper right here shows the climate of Darwin, Australia. Now, this city is located in a tropical wet dry climate because of its seasonal differences in rainfall and relatively stable temperature ranges. Notice that it receives most of its rainfall between November and April. Now, because Darwin is located south of the equator, its summer falls between December and April. Now, the graph on the bottom left here is the mid-latitude wet climate of Wellington, New Zealand. It receives the largest amount of rainfall during its winter months, but precipitation continues throughout the year because of its temperature ranges from 8.5 to 17 Celsius. Wellington is considered a mid-latitude climate instead of a tropical climate. Now, the graph on the bottom left here is the hot desert climate of Cook, Australia. This desert region of Australia differs from other hot deserts and climates within the region, and climates within the region differ greatly as well. Now, Cook has the lowest average rainfall of any other city in Australia. So keep in mind that most cities in the Australian outback have more rainfall than is shown in this particular graph right here. And while rainfall is relatively low in Cook, it receives consistent rainfall throughout the year with no significant changes between months. The temperature ranges from 11 Celsius in the winter and 24 Celsius in the summer. All right, so the recent melting of glaciers in the Arctic have led some climate scientists to conclude that rising sea levels will impact coral atolls in the Pacific really the most. Because of the way that atolls form, many of these islands have elevations of less than 5 meters, so any major changes in ocean levels can make these islands virtually disappear. The problem is that research has shown conflicting results about sea level rise in the Pacific. Some scholars argue that sea levels are rising on a global scale, but other scholars claim that there are major regional differences. Now, the article on the left here was published in 2018 by the United States Geological Survey and claims that atolls will be uninhabitable by the mid-21st century due to sea level rise. However, the article on the right here claims that islands such as Tuvalu are actually increasing due to growth in the island's structure. Now, we should also be careful when blaming sea level rise in the Pacific on climate changes. Some of the rising ocean trends in the Pacific are due to seasonal climatic changes from El Nino and La Nina, as reported here in this particular article headline. So let's see if we can take a look at these articles really quickly and get an idea of what the claims are. Excuse me. The impact of sea level rise and climate change on Pacific atolls that house Department of Defense installations. Now, this study is a collaboration between U.S. Geological Survey, National Oceanic and Atmospheric, Oceanographic and Atmospheric Administration, DELTARS, and the University of Hawaii. The goal of the studies are to provide basic understandings and specific information on storm wave-induced overwash and inundation of atoll islets that house Department of Defense installations and assess the resulting impact of sea level rise and storm wave inundation on infrastructure and freshwater availability under a variety of sea level rise and climatic scenarios. Based on historical information, sea level rise predictions in the global model, wind, wave, and precipitation output. Sea level in the Western Pacific has been increasing at a rate of 2 to 3 times the global average, resulting in an almost 0.3 meters of net rise since 1990. At the right, observed trends in sea level between 1993 and 2010. Note the high rates of sea level rise in the Pacific Ocean and Central Indian Oceans, where Department of Defense managed atolls are located. In 2012, U.S. National Climate Assessment provided global sea level rise scenarios that ranged from 0.2 to 2.0 meters by 2100. Regional scenarios are needed. And that's a key important note to make here, is that this is based on global models, not regional or local models. So keep that in mind. So let's see what this other article says here from phys.org, titled Sinking Pacific Nation is Getting Bigger Study. The Pacific nation of Tuvalu, long seen as a prime candidate to disappear as climate change forces up sea levels, is actually growing in size, new research shows. The University of Auckland study examined changes in the geography of Tuvalu's 9 atolls and 101 reef islands between 1971 and 2014. Using aerial photographs and satellite imagery, it found 8 of the atolls and almost 3/4 of the island grew during the study period, lifting Tuvalu's total land area by 2.9%, even though sea levels in the country rose at twice the global average, Co-author Paul Kinch said the research published Friday in the Journal of Nature Communications challenged the assumption that low-lying island nations could be swamped as the sea rose. Quote, we tend to think of Pacific atolls as static landforms that will simply be inundated as sea level rise, but there is growing evidence that these islands are geologically dynamic and are constantly changing. The study findings may seem counterintuitive, given that sea levels have been rising in the region over the past half century, but the dominant mode of change over that time on Tuvalu has been expansion, not erosion. So this is actually a good note for the island of Tuvalu. So let's see what this other article says. Headlines exaggerate climate link to sinking of Pacific Islands. Report author says many media outlets have misinterpreted the science by conflating sea level rise with climate change. Links between climate change and the sinking of five islands in the Pacific Ocean have been exaggerated, the author of a widely reported new study has said. The report published on Friday tracked the shape-shifting of 33 reef islands in the Solomon Islands between 1947 and 2014, found that five had been washed away completely and six more had been severely eroded. The study blamed the loss on a combination of sea level rise and high wave energy. Many media outlets, including The Guardian, jumped to the conclusion that the islands were lost to climate change, but this largely misinterprets the science, according to the study's author, Dr. Simon Albert. Quote, all these headlines are certainly pushing things a bit towards the climate change has made islands vanish angle. I would prefer a slightly more moderate title that focuses on sea level rise being the driver rather than simply climate change. The major misunderstanding stems from the conflation of sea level rise with climate change. As a scientifically robust and potentially destructive articulation of climate change, sea level rise has become almost synonymous with the warming of the planet. However, as Albert's paper points out, the ocean has been rising in the Solomon Islands at 7 millimeters per year, more than double the global average. Since the 1990s, trade winds in the Pacific have been particularly intense. This has been driven partly by global warming and partly by climatic cycles, in particular the Pacific Decadal Oscillation, also known as El Niño and La Niña. These trade winds have basically pushed water up into Western Pacific and have driven these exceptionally high rates of sea level rise in the Solomons. The trade winds are partly a natural cycle, but also the recent intensification is related to atmospheric warming. So the main reason I presented these three articles here is to remind you that we should be careful and not draw conclusions based solely on what the media has stated as fact. Keep an open mind and do your own research. As stated earlier, Australia broke away from Gondwanaland around 200 million years ago and has been separated by water since then. Because of this relative isolation, unique breeds of flora and fauna have developed and evolved over the past 200 million years, making Australia one of the most unique natural areas on Earth. Some major examples of unique animals only found on Australia and surrounding islands are kangaroos, wallabies, koalas, Tasmanian devils, and wombats, all part of the marsupial infraclass of mammals. Now, these animals lay eggs and raise their young in pouches below their chests. Now, the dingo, shown here, is not a marsupial, but a mammal that gives live birth to their young. The platypus, shown here, is also a mammal that gives live births. Now, this animal that is pictured on the right down here is another unusual animal home to Australia called a thorny devil dragon. Now, this is the only species of devil lizard found in Australia and is a small species of lizard known for its defenses against predators. Now, unfortunately, in the late 17 and early 1800s, the British would introduce new animals and plant species to Australia, which essentially led to a dramatic decline in some of these endemic species across the continent. Now, new measures have been taken by the governments of Australia and New Zealand to stop some of the extinction level events that have taken place in some of these particular locations. So the relative isolation and size of Australia and the Pacific have left this region separated from interaction with Europe, Asia, Africa, and the Americas for thousands of years, giving it time to develop its own unwritten history. Several theories have been proposed for the migration of Austronesian peoples across the Pacific, but we will only have time to discuss three in any really significant detail. Scholars have argued that the possible causes for the Austronesian migration was overpopulation, deforestation, and/or military expansion, but these reasons don't often apply equally across space. Now, recent evidence reveal that the Polynesians in particular were master sailors that built outrigging canoes and mapped the entire Pacific Ocean. In fact, new archaeological findings suggest that Polynesians built an extensive trading network between islands and with North and South America. Now, the Portuguese would finally come in contact with the Pacific Islands in 1512 when Antonio de Abreu, reached the Maluku Islands located just west of New Guinea. Ferdinand Magellan and his crew would finally arrive in Polynesia in 1521. By 1606, Luis Vaez de Torres would see the Horn of Australia as he passed through the what would later become known as the Torres Strait. Finally, in 1688, William Dampier, a British explorer, would land on the northwestern coast of Australia and claim the land for the British Empire. The most famous of these British explorers was Captain Cook, who would begin his voyages in 1768, map several of the islands in the Pacific and much of the Australian coast. This would lead to the colonization of Australia by Britain in 1788, when King George and Arthur Phillip sent Philip Gidley King and several prisoners to the new continent to establish a penal colony. Now, this would lead to the death of thousands of Aborigines at the hand of the British. Now, according to this slide, migration across the Pacific possibly occurred due to deforestation, overpopulation, and climate changes around 2500 BC. Expansion continued to Melanesia, where Austronesians mixed with Austroasiatic people. Droughts may have led to the migrations around out of Melanesia around 700 to 800 AD. Now, the express train model of Polynesian migration argues that between 3000 and 1000 BC, the Austronesian people migrated out of Taiwan, located here, moved through the Philippines down here, and into New Guinea, finally arriving in Melanesia by 1400 BC. By 900 BC, the Austronesians would make it to Western Polynesia, located here in Samoa. Now, this theory, supported by the majority of current genetic, linguistic, and archaeological data, and so therefore it is the most popular explanation for this migration. However, the entangled bank model, argues that that migration goes back a lot further than the express train model. This model claims that the long history of Austronesian linguistic culture and genetic interaction with indigenous Southeast Asian and Melanesians lends credence to the idea that earlier settlement patterns were started by Southeast Asians. Now, the slow boat model is the third and final one that we'll discuss. It is similar to the express train model, but argues that the Austronesian people stayed in Melanesia much longer than hypothesized by the express train model. According to this theory, the Austronesians that settled in Melanesia intermarried with local Austroasiatic people until eventually a group moved out of Polynesia much later than 900 BC. Now, this model is supported by the Y chromosome data of Kaser et al. 2000, which shows that all three haplotypes of Polynesia Y chromosome can be traced back to Melanesia. Now, the problem with determining exactly when and how Pacific Islanders migrated across the ocean is the lack in historical records and limited archaeological artifacts in many islands. Of course, early scholars assumed Pacific Islanders were too stupid to purposely explore the Pacific, so many of these academics claimed that the Austronesians must have island-hopped due to overpopulation and climate changes, thereby accidentally finding these islands. However, recent evidence suggests that these islanders had sophisticated shipping technology, which was more advanced than Europeans at the time of the Phoenicians and Greeks. Now, the pictures on the left, show double canoes used to explore the Pacific Ocean. Single canoes often had outriggers that helped to stabilize the ship in rough waters. Now, these double canoes here were fitted with two triangular sails, as you can see here, and here is another alternative version of that. But the single outrigger canoes often had single triangular sails, which was a technology that the Europeans wouldn't adopt until the mid-1400s. Now, if you want to learn more about the shipping technology of the Polynesians and possibly an alternative theory to their migration, you can also read Thor Heyerdahl's book titled Early Man and the Ocean. It is a very thick book, but it has some very interesting theories as to the migration patterns. According to his thesis, he believes that the Polynesians had actually not originated in Melanesia as previously thought, but actually originated in South America and moved through the prevailing winds across the Pacific Ocean. Interesting hypothesis, but many scholars have scoffed at this and essentially laughed at Thor Heyerdahl's findings. But you'll have to take it for yourself. It's always good to read alternative opinions. So as stated earlier, early European explorers looked down on the Polynesian and dismissed any suggestions of advanced technologies. However, scholars have recently discovered ancient Polynesian shell maps of ocean swells and islands across the region, suggesting that these people were far more advanced than previously thought. According to the slide, ancient Polynesians used maps to navigate around the vastness of the Pacific. Without a written language, they instead utilized local materials to pass on information. The shells on this map indicate islands or island groups, and the sticks show ocean swells and their direction. Swells change direction as the islands, as they pass islands. Now let's watch this short clip here from National Geographic titled South Pacific Migration History.
The largest single feature on our planet, covering one-third of the Earth's surface, is the majestic Pacific Ocean. Scattered across this vast expanse, like so many stars in the heavens, more than 25,000 islands dot its surface. Volcanic action and the shifting of the Earth's crust thrust these islands up from the depths. Wind and water combined to create soil that would sustain vegetation. Over millennia, plants found their way from Asia, Indonesia, and Australia. The islands grew green and soon played host to abundant animal life. Species by species, the varieties of plant and animal life increased, and the web of life became more complex. The next great wave of migration would be human. About 5,000 years ago, population pressures drove these future Polynesians from their Asian homes. First, they moved through the Fijian Islands, then eastward to Samoa and Tonga. From there, they swept through Tahiti and French Polynesia, extending their domain as far as the Marquesas. Around 2,000 years ago, these intrepid sailors navigated north to the Hawaiian Islands, south to Easter Island, and even on to New Zealand to complete the remarkable feat of populating the islands of the Pacific. Much later, the voyages of Magellan, Cook, Darwin, and others would seed Europe with stories of a paradise in the South Pacific where friendly natives lived carefree under tropical skies, where ownership was unknown and unnecessary, and nature's bounty was everywhere. Such tales gave the islands the reputation they still enjoy today.
Particular has a fascinating history and is much more advanced than previously thought. In fact, the Polynesians may have reached the Americas hundreds of years before the Europeans. Recent archaeological evidence shows that Polynesian ships may have traded goods between the Americas and even settled in coastal villages in California and Chile. Sweet potatoes, ceramics, chickens, and sunken boats have been found in several locations. Now the map on the left here shows the exchange of sweet potatoes, bottled gourds, and chickens between Polynesians and South Americans. Languages were also shared between these cultures, as several similar words exist across several Native American and Polynesian societies. One example is the Chumash word for the sewn plank canoe, which is tomo'lo'o, while the Hawaiian word for useful tree is kumolo'o. Now, the Chumash tribe of Southern California is one of the few Native American tribes that built a seagoing vessel, and its construction was similar to the Hawaiian canoes. Planks of wood were sewn together using roots and branches that would expand when wet to close the holes in the wood. Now, you can see a diagram of this here on this the bottom right of this slide. Now, many scholars have refused to accept that Polynesians had built a trading network with America, but linguistic, DNA, and archaeological evidence is beginning to show that these people were far more advanced than previously thought. So if we fast forward to the 1600s, Europeans set their eyes on colonizing the Pacific Islands in Australia. They would eventually land in Australia in 1606 when Dutch navigator Wilhelm Janszoon sailed through Torres Strait to Cape York Peninsula. He claimed it for Holland. Now in 1688, English explorer William Dampier stopped for maintenance in King Sound in northwest Australia. By 1768, English explorer James Cook would be assigned the job of exploring and mapping the Pacific Ocean in Australia. He would map the east coast and most of Pacific Islands throughout the late 1700s until he was essentially killed in Hawaii in 1779. The map on the left of the slide shows English exploration of Australia compared to Dutch exploration routes. The English were far more interested in Australia than other European nations and would begin colonization in the 1780s. The map on the upper right here is the finalized drawing sent to the King of England by James Cook. The picture on the upper right here is a photograph of William Dampier, and of course this is Captain Cook. Finally, the map on the bottom right shows all of Captain Cook's voyages. Notice the extensive distances he traveled over the just 11 years. Now by 1787, the British would claim Eastern Australia and name it New South Wales. That same year, New Zealand would become part of New South Wales as well. First established as a penal colony for both minor and major crimes, Australia was settled by prisoners who were promised freedom in a new land in exchange for hard labor. Many prisoners remained indebted for their entire lives. Now, Aboriginal land was taken without treaty. Unfortunately, Australia was already settled by a group of people known today as Aborigines. The Aborigines at the time of the British arrival lived in villages and practiced a type of communal living not known by the British at the time. Around this time, Britain had established rules regarding land acquisition, as you can see here. These laws required that land could be added as colonies if they were either purchased, ceded after war, or voluntarily given by the local population. Because Aboriginal tribes did not practice property ownership in the same manner as the British, the Crown declared Australia terra nullius, or nobody's land, which meant that the British did not have to get permission to cede all of Australia. Now this would result in the bloody destruction and mass murder of the Aboriginal people until laws were eventually passed ending the murder of these indigenous peoples. So before we finish this presentation, I would like to focus on one of the most interesting islands in the Pacific. Rapa Nui is also known as Easter Island, is believed to be to have been settled around 300 AD. It had an advanced hierarchical society with a king and local lords. Over a period of about 1,000 years, the Rapa Nui people erected nearly 887 fully erect Moai statues. Scholars today think that Rapa Nui was settled by explorers from Mangareva, and it is believed that to have had a population of 30,000 people at its height. High society existed with several tribes working together as a confederacy. Ironically, construction of the Moai required so many trees, it caused deforestation. Drought from the mid-Pacific Oscillation would follow and society would eventually crumble. The map on the right here shows the location of Moai statues around the borders of Rapa Nui, and the red arrow here points to the quarry where these statues were made. Now, the statues were then carried across great distances to their current locations on these islands. Now, scholars disagree as to how these statues were created and then carried to their locations, but Rapa Nui mythology states that these statues walked to their current locations. Some scholars have built complex contraptions to test ways to move these statues without wheels, but many of these methods are highly inefficient. The picture on the bottom here shows one of these methods. According to this theory, statues were placed on sleds and dragged to their current locations. Now, other scholars have suggested that the statues pictured here had been made to walk by the indigenous people of Rapa Nui, tying ropes around their heads and rocking these statues back and forth until they made it to their current locations. Now, because of the massive number of trees required to move these monuments and subsequent drought that followed, Rapa Nui's society eventually collapsed. By the time the Spanish arrived in 1770, only 3,000 people remained. When Captain Cook arrived in 1774, numbers had dropped to between 600 to 700 people, with only 30 women. Some anthropologists have suggested that famine resulted in cannibalism. Others have claimed that the island was once covered in large palm trees and thick forests, but as you can see from these two pictures here on the right, the island has since succumbed to mass deforestation. Today, Rapa Nui is home to about 7,750 people and is a major tourist destination. So let's watch this quick clip from National Geographic titled End of Easter Island.
Early inhabitants cleared countless trees to build their society.
Slash and burn agriculture, it could be very destructive. They were clearing larger and larger expanses of land, cutting down the forests to feed more people.
Over the centuries, the population grew by the thousands. Harvested trees became canoes and shelters. But many were felled for the sake of one singular obsession. Building Moai. Nearly all of the massive statues were carved from the soft stone of a single quarry. The islanders considered each to embody the spirit of their ancestors. Some statues are over 30 feet tall and weigh more than 80 tons. These monoliths were moved from the quarry up to 6 miles across uneven terrain without the benefit of large animals or the wheel. It is believed that trees could have been used as posts for rope systems, or as rollers, or levers, to make sleds, or even as tracts that were laid across the island. Virtually all of these methods would have required that the trunks were frequently replaced. The Moai are made larger and larger as the centuries pass.
It seems like through time, there was strong competition for not only building great monuments to honor the ancestors, but also among chiefs for prestige and status.
Hundreds of statues still litter the hillside, many abandoned in the process of moving or being carved, frozen in time. One, known as El Gigante, the giant, would have stood over 7 stories high. It suggests the islanders' ambition may have been greater than their resources. In the space of just a few centuries, the trees were used up.
This is especially true when you consider the location of the island of Rapa Nui in the South Pacific. As you can see, here is its location, and then here is the equator. And so Rapa Nui is one of the few islands that doesn't exist within the tropics in the Pacific region. That being said, it receives most of its rainfall during the summer months, and because of that, if any drought comes along, then this can have a major adverse effect on the societies that live here. And recent evidence from tree ring data in other islands across the South Pacific suggests that this drought coincided with a series of droughts from neighboring islands as well, making it very difficult for them to receive resources from partners across the ocean. It's an interesting history that we really are only beginning to understand today. So that's about it for us today. I just want to say thank you for watching again, and please have a great day. Thank you.